Today's webinar is hosted by Alison Bickford, and she's the Director of Connect Thinking. Before we get started, I'm just going to launch a few polls so that, number one, you can interact with Alison, and number two, she can get a better idea of who's actually online today during the webinar, and then hopefully tailor the content to meet your needs. So the first poll is simple. What do you do? Are you an educator or a trainer? Are you an information or knowledge manager? Are you a small business owner? Or perhaps other? And if you are selecting other, which is number four, simply type into the messages box in the bottom right-hand corner what other best describes you, and that way we can get a better indication as to who's online today. So we can see that coming through, and we can see that 54% of people are actually educators or trainers, which is great. And we can also see people type into the messages box. The next poll is have you ever? So have you ever used video as part of an online learning strategy? So maybe you have extensively, maybe you have a little bit, or maybe you haven't at all. And we can see those polls changing in live time. And from what we can see now, if you look on the middle of the screen, you can see that the majority of people have done a little bit here and there. So with that in mind, I'll pass on to Alison to get the webinar started. And what do you think of those polls so far, Alison?
Yeah, look, that's very interesting. And I'm hoping that this next hour will give some people some new ideas and some thoughts to take back to their workplaces and their practice. So welcome, everyone, and thank you very much for joining us on today's webinar series from Redback. Today, we're going to cover these four topics, five kinds of instructional approaches for designing video for teaching and learning. Hopefully, the approaches that I give you on a single slide will help categorise what you're intending to do with video and how it fits into your strategy. Also, we'll be looking at top tools and tips for producing video for learning, and I'll give you some ideas on what I do for video for my own practice. I won't be able to share client video stories, but I can show you my own as examples. We'll be describing the best video platforms and emerging trends. I mean, I think video has a long way to go, and for people who have businesses or who are training, it's a wonderful opportunity. And tricks for keeping people online and engaged. Video is fantastic for doing. YouTube. What a wonderful blessing YouTube has been for educators and for people who have businesses. Of course, we know that, or we've heard that YouTube is the second most searched platform after Google. The prevalence of YouTube has helped people get used to video. In fact, they've developed a type of YouTube habit where people expect that YouTube and video will give them answers to how do I type questions. Other advantages of YouTube is that you can embed YouTube videos into other platforms such as the intranet. And it's really useful to get a YouTube account and to have a look at what YouTube offers people with accounts, because it gets us a sense of what we can expect from video platforms when we go out to look for buying them. Its analytics, its editing abilities are very powerful. Another advantage of YouTube, for those who want to share video on YouTube, is that Google TV is just around the corner, and Google's preference for video and promotion of video on Google search engine itself makes it a very useful thing to do, is to have a video strategy. Well, the other very important thing that's happened in the last few years is mobile devices and smartphones. As Einstein said, I never try to remember anything but I can look up. And I think that's what the value and power of mobile devices is offering all of us. And so that means that video has a very important and powerful position for just-in-time performance support. For those who might be out in the field and need to learn in time, what do I need to do to paint this bridge or to check that a bridge is sound, for example? People are using, of course, videos to take photos of what they have done out in the field. And, of course, not to mention in the workplace and in the offices where people are using videos to remind themselves on how to use software that they may not use every day. The other important thing of video, and people will know this from iTunes Store in particular, for those who are Apple users, is the opportunity to listen to an expert on video while on the bus or on the train, and to reflect on their practice while listening to those experts. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. So any questions at this point?
No, none so far, Alison.
Thanks very much. Thank you. Now, this is what I've tried to do to try and to give people an idea of where video plays for learning. And I say there's five kinds of video, and we'll just spend a moment going through these. The first is conceptual or briefing videos. These are videos whose purpose is to give people an overview of a concept to support their mental models and expectations. Now, some of those overviews may be couched in a story, which is very, very powerful. But say, for example, that I'm asked to learn, as I did the other day, how to do a particular thing in Moodle. Now, that's what I would call how-to type videos. Something that would have helped me to actually design something in Moodle would have been useful. However, what I was missing was a conceptual understanding of what Moodle is, generally speaking. And so there is a hand-to-hand relationship between giving people conceptual information in learning, or might be called briefing, and procedural type videos, the how-to. So the how-to is the detailed, stepwise approach to teaching people a process. Examples include job aids or other work instructions. The third type of video for learning is what I call in-depth expertise. These are videos of experts' opinions and expert experiences. People may hear this from Harvard Business School or from the TED video podcast series, which gives us an opportunity to listen to other perspectives and to reflect on our own practice. Recordings, very powerful. Editing is commonly involved, but whether it be a recording of a workshop or indeed, as we're doing today, a recording of a webinar is very useful as part of a content strategy to develop artifacts that people can reuse. And finally, using video as an evaluation activity in learning, where we can ask groups of people to demonstrate their level of understanding by taking a video of a task. Is there any questions in relation to these five kinds of videos for learning?
Not as yet, but if anyone does have any questions, please, as requested, type them into the messages box in the bottom right, left-hand corner.
Fantastic. Down the bottom, by the way, is a URL to my video for organisational learning YouTube series on my YouTube channel, which is called eLearning Academy. So in Redback, that's an active hyperlink, so if anyone wants to click away for a moment and have a look at that, they're very welcome, or you can have a look at it after the seminar is finished. What I'd be interested to know now is to get an idea of what the audience love about video. So what I'd like you to do is to use the chat box at the bottom of your screen and write a sentence on what do you love about video? What's cool for you? It's real fantastic. What else? Theo suggests that there's a human connection with video. Helen suggests you can review it. Review it at your leisure, anytime, any place. Yeah, isn't visual a powerful thing? Thank you, Anita. Yep, refer back to it, as I was saying. When you forget, refer back to video. Fantastic. Yes, using visual as well as audio is far more powerful to explain something to someone than audio alone. Did I miss any there? Sarah, that any phase you just saw going by?
I really agree with David's response, and I definitely can agree with that. And people don't really want to read instructions anymore. Video is easy and much more engaging, don't you think, Alison?
Oh, look, as a matter of fact, 2 years ago I spent a little bit of money on my website and put a video on the first three pages of my Connect Thinking website and two on the first page of my eLearning Academy website. And what I noticed from the analytics is that I actually had an increase in time of people staying on those pages. So I totally agree with David that people scan online, but they will listen to a video. Mm-hmm. We don't read anymore so much anymore. So thank you very much, everyone, for sharing your thoughts on that. I've got another question I'd like to ask you now, because this gets to the crux of today's session, which is what stops you from using more video in your practice? If you could use the chat function. Thanks very much. Time. Time to develop, yes. Bandwidth, cost, I'm seeing a lot of time, the challenges of producing good video, learning how to use the software yourself in editing. Okay, and it sounds like Marion has a real keen idea on, really wants to know how I do it and who's going to help me get the results I'm looking for. And they're all very important points because we want to get a sense of what we think is good so that we can explain to others the concept for those things that are good and then try and make it repeatable in our own videos. Was there anything, Sarah, that you just saw then yourself?
I think it was really recurring in terms of time and how, and also the cost, as Lois has just said. And Wendy's made a good point about free software that's out there as well. So cost definitely seems to be something that's stopping everyone from probably moving forward with video.
Yeah, indeed. Let's address some of those, in particular cost and time, in the next screen. Final question I'd like to ask the group is, in your opinion, what do you think creates an engaging video? So when you're looking in your mind's eye of what you want your quality video to be, what is it that you think it needs? What is the essence? So what creates an engaging video? Relevance, thank you. Succinct and to the point, absolutely. Short, not just a talking head. Humour, controversy, lovely. Short and concise. Any others there? The right person to attract audience. That's interesting. That's an interesting comment. Okay. Organised and structured. Fantastic. I guess, Christine, what you're perhaps you might be meaning there is that people are still trying to, they're virtual learners and they're still trying to understand the concept. So a start, a middle and an end, and having visuals that actually support the audio is very useful.
I think humour is quite interesting. I think you tend to see online, whether it be through social media sharing as well, that any sort of video that has a bit of humour to it definitely goes a lot further than those videos that aren't quite humorous, don't they, Alison?
Well, they end up on the Ellen Show.
Yeah, that's right.
Yes, look, I'm afraid for those who do look at my videos, you won't see a lot of humour. I'm a little bit serious when it comes to my video series, but we'll talk about those sort of decisions around what you want that your video series to encompass, because they're important decision points. Okay, so thank you very much for that.